The pylons that you see here, the books and stones, as it says in the Pur Imaru. The Pur Imaru, the books and stone, mean everywhere you see on the temple, you see the Netter Shishata. Okay, or the Medu Netcher as well. The Medu Netcher carved in the temple everywhere. The first language, long before Aramaic, long before these contemporary languages of the day, all over the temple. Medu Netter, all over the temple. You're in the books and stone, brothers and sisters. So when you look at the Medu Netcher here, I mean, this is truly the books and stone. What makes written on paper, where the name gets its name from papyrus, what makes this written on paper more sacred than is written on the books in stone? It goes back thousands of years. A spiritual stories and writings and representation where here we see Ursima Atra Septepa Ra III carved 10 inches into the temple. Let's go on the other side and I can show you clearly some of the Medu Netcher that the Greeks referred to as the hieroglyphics. Okay, and many of the Greeks could not even read the Medu Netcher. So you saw many of the shenus were blank. This is long before Aramaic, long before Hebrew, long before Arabic, long before the Sumerian writing. We see the earliest writing known to the world in the books in stone to give validation. And Ramesu, look at this. He made that where you can stick your hand all the way up into the Medu Netcher. So it could not be erased. And here you have repetitions of spiritual ideas, and here we have the Sutenbet, Neb-Tui, the dog figure, Ursa, Ma'at, Ra, Muri, Amen, Sa, Ra, Neb, Karu, Ramesu. Now, what's it saying here? The king of Upper and Lower Egypt, okay? The king of Upper and Lower Egypt, okay, Neb-Tui, the lord of the two lands, that's Tameri and Ta-Nehisi, okay, Ursa, the power of Ra, okay, Amen, Ma'at, that means truth, justice, and righteousness, loved by Amen, look at this, Sa-Ra, son of God, then Neb-Kadu, lord, king of kings. Where have you heard lord, king of kings at? And the Bible, huh? Is that right? And Revelations, Lord, King of Kings. That came out of Neb-Kadu. That means Lord, King of Kings, plural. Okay? And Ramesh, he's born of Ramesh. He's born of Ramesh. So this is where many ideas were taken out of the ancient Medu Netcher. So Son of God, Neb-Kadu, Lord, King of Kings, also Septepen Ra. Septepen Ra means, I don't see it on the temple here now, Septepen Ra means chosen by God. So these are the ancient spiritual story that others came and literally plagiarized many ideas from these Medu Netcher, and this became the best kept secret in the Western world. Not to reveal where the Western world got many of its ideas directly out of the Medu Netcher itself. Most of what we know about the Medu Netcher is through the Rosetta Stone. That was illegally taken by Napoleon's army in 1799. And here, this goes back to the priesthood of Menefer, forced to honor Ptolemies. The Ptolemies took over after Alexander, the fifth of Epiphanes, in around 196 BCE. When the Romans came here, nobody could read the Medu Netcher. That's why some of the shenus are blank, that the Karyhabs didn't acknowledge these Greeks on the throne like the Ptolemies. And how did they break some of the code? They have not been able to decipher all of the Medu Netcher. They have been able to decipher some of it, but it had an esoteric and exoteric interpretation. So Champollion, when Napoleon's army came here, they stole a stone called Rosetta Stone and they dealt it in a place called Rosetta. And they took that stone back to Europe and they started to study this stone. What is this message? What are they saying on these temples? As you see, the Medu Netcher is everywhere, so it was a mystery. It was an ancient language at this time. And then Champollion was able to see, he was able to read Greek, and he was able to decipher Cleopatra the VII name and the Demotic. And then he was able to decipher a lot of, as the Greeks called the Medu Netcher, heretic. And then they were able to break the code on the surface, but you had a priestly language, which more is an esoteric, okay, language, and an exoteric language, an inner and outer. They've never to this day reached the inner meaning of the Medu nature. But Champollion came and carved his name right there, Champollion, on the temple. Did he climb up there on a ladder to do it? No. At that time, when they came in here, these temples were covered in sand, so it was probably at a distance about right here that he was able to write it. That's why when you look up at the temples, in many cases, when you see names up there, that's because the dirt was up that high. You saw the lecture, they only dug these temples out in the turn of the century. Just a couple more things before we move. Keep in mind, when you say Egyptology, that's connected to white supremacy and the colonial period of Egypt. That's what Egyptology is. They literally cut out a piece of Africa and called it Egyptology. If we call it anything, we should call it Kemetology or Africanology. But Egyptology is equated with white supremacy and colonialism. Also, that before Champollion, there was a Jesuit priest who came through here named Adnapius Keshner. Adnapius Keshner, who was a Jesuit priest, was the one who tried to decipher the Medu nature. And some have called Champollion the father of deciphering the Medu nature. But I don't think that Adnapius Keshner, Champollion, or Thomas Young, I don't think none of them deciphered the deep meaning of the Medu nature. The Medu nature, the hieroglyphics you see at the top, then we have Demotic, and then we have Greek. Well, Thomas Young and Champollion, they could read Greek, and they were able to decipher Cleopatra's name in the Demotic. That's how they were able to decipher some of the Medu nature, but not all of it, because it had esoteric as well as exoteric interpretation. So there was some for the priestly writing, which was the deep Medu nature that the Greeks called the hieroglyphics, and other spiritual systems. But when the French came in, Napoleon brought all his scientists here to Egypt. This was fascinating to see this. It was unknown. By the time the Roman time was over, nobody could read the Medu nature, even during the Roman times. To see this, it was unknown. The temples were under the sand. So when you go into the temple, it did not always look like that. But they came in many cases, plundered, took reliefs, and so forth, that you see in the British Museum, you see it in the Louvre, you see it in New York City. Many cases, these reliefs have been chiseled out. You have to go to Europe to see them. This is important right here because it gives you an idea of how many Europeans came through here and chiseled out a lot of the Medu nature, the world's first language. This is long before Aramaic, long before Hebrew, long before Arabic. Here we see the Medu nature, the sacred language of God, and how the extent that they have gone through chiseling out pieces. In many cases, you have to go to European museums to see the ancient Medu nature. If you look at these columns, look at the columns there, just pretty much erased bare. There was Medu nature all over the columns. Like you see the column right over here, you see Medu nature is still up there. But these here have totally been erased, totally wiped out. How long would this go on? When we go through our awakening, would the sacred language and messages still be on these ancient temples for us to read? Where the African Kemetic spiritual stories were told for thousands of years? So this is still going on. So when you see all these columns here that erase like they are, this is, in many cases, you got to go into those museums and you'll see big walls of rugged reliefs of Medu nature everywhere. And where did it come from? It came from right here, where they came in and chiseled it out, or during the time when they came through here and these temples were wide open and Muhammad Ali was doing everything to sell off the treasures and dismantling temples and so forth. This has been an ongoing process, has been done. And to show you how sad it is, see over there, the Medu nature straight in the back. Now look how they actually took the reliefs off. So is that how it's going to look on the temple in the future? See how they took and made a sketch of what used to be there? See the arcs over there? So they sketched in what they literally took out. Look at the top where they sketched in where the men are walking with the left leg forward. You see the falcon up there of Heru, and he's holding in his talons the Shin symbol. That Shin symbol to the far left, that is represents eternity. They're actually taking off the Medu Netcher and now sketching in what actually is being taken. This whole temple may end up like that, with a sketch of what originally the Medu Netcher actually existed. So are they eventually going to sketch out what's left and take off all the rest? That's the question that's got to be asked here. Will we come through here one day and all we will see are the black linings of the sketch that used to be of Mut and all the others? So even as far back in the 80s, I've seen where many of the reliefs have literally been taken off. When I'm in England, I see a lot of these Medu Netcher. You go to Metropolitan New York, you see it. In many cases, a lot of people are going to Europe to see Egypt now. A lot of people are not studying Egypt here. They're studying Egypt in schools in Europe and America for what they took from here. And this is sad. Egypt has gone through a whole thing trying to get a lot of the stuff that was stolen from Egypt back. And Mary Ra witnessed when she was in the Cairo Museum the repatriation of some of the pieces, some small little pieces that England returned back to Egypt. There were little tiny pieces in the corner, and she said there was a little sign there of the repatriation. Metropolitan. Oh, it came from the Metropolitan? Yeah, so the Metropolitan Museum turned some little pieces. All those pieces they got in the Metropolitan Museum? So it's like an insult that here's a little bit of crumbs that they're going to give back. So all those colossal statues that you see there, all that, like Belzoni and others who came through here, and at one time Egypt was wide open for everybody to take whatever they wanted. So Belzoni, he's the one that took a lot of those statues that's in the British Museum, and they just drug them out of here, put them on boats and carried them to Europe. Okay, it was what, you know, they could do what they wanted to do with it. So hopefully there'll be an awakening here to get a lot of those treasures that they stole out of Egypt and returned back to Egypt. How much of the temple will still be here when we have finally emancipated our mind, when our ancestors left on the temples of eternity and the books in stone, our ancestral sacred knowledge of liberation and emancipation, as well as a spiritual emancipation and salvation for the soul. All of that was taught here. So over the years, I have witnessed, as I said, back in the 80s, of them, I mean, I came right here, they had people here just hacking away. We are still in a deep sleep. You would never see this happen to other people's treasures without an outcry. Go to the Vatican and start tearing down some statues and carrying it to Egypt, huh? Go down there and start tearing down some of those popes and see if you can do it and bring them to the museums here. We wouldn't want it anyway, all right? Go dig up old George and dig up King James, all right? But they dig up our ancestors. They tear off the relief, desecrates the temple. All these things have been done over the millennia and plunderers who have come through here. But even now, it still blows our mind, but you have to keep in mind, you're looking at the skeletal remains. And the skeletal remains blows your mind, and nothing equals this in the world. I mean, you go to the Parthenon, it cannot even match this temple, and you're in the baby temple. For many years, I have seen the plaster that was put over Amenhotep III, and this was done by the Byzantine Roman Christians. They even built a chapel down inside here where they actually used the temple for a church. As I said, if the temple was supposed to be so pagan and so heathen, then why use it as a church? And also, you can see some of the plaster still here, where at one time this plaster covered up Amenhotep III, divine birth, okay, from his mother, from his spiritual mother, Mut. Even though his physical mother is Matanwea, but his spiritual mother is Mut, and his spiritual father is Amen. This is an early Immaculate Conception and Resurrection story going back over 3,000 years ago of the 18th dynasty. This is long before the Immaculate Conception story that we know in Rome or the Byzantine Christians. But also, this plaster was all over there. This was the Romans put their face here. They repainted this to bring out the Byzantine Roman Christian images. They had nothing to do with this. When this temple was built, there was no Rome. There was no Greece. There was no Byzantine Christians at this time. So they actually plastered, originally, the Byzantine Romans plastered over all of this. But this plaster is slowly taken off where we can see now Amenhotep III of the 18th dynasty and his divine birth from his spiritual mother Mut and the Immaculate Conception taking place. And you can see the plaster is now taken off and trying to restore it to its original place. But at the same time, the images of the Byzantine Roman Christians are still up there. And then the demonizing and vilifying, when many Europeans came through here from the time of the Romans, desecrating the ancient temple. Originally, these temples were colored, beautiful colors. I mean, what you're looking at now is in ruins over 3,000 years. It did not look like this as you see it today, but it kind of gave you an idea of nature. Now look at the top, and you can see in 1820 where Italino, okay, where they carved their names. Did they climb up there and do that? No. See over there in the corner, you see that from the left, the second column from the left, on the left, at the top. Can you see it? 1820, see, no, they didn't climb up there. The temple was under the sand. The temple was under the dirt. They only dug the temple out to make tourist dollars. But originally, this temple was covered all the way up to that area there, and that's how they enabled them to carve their names, put in graffiti, and names like that you'll see continuously when you travel through many of the other temples that we're going to go through. You're looking at the books in stone. You come into the temple. There's so much to see. Brothers and sisters will be walking through the temple, and there's so many things I want to point out. We can't point out everything. We're going to highlight as much as we can as we walk through here.
Ashra and Mary Rakwesi are lecturers on African history, civilization, religion, and culture. The duo present lively and dynamic presentations and video productions based on their extensive study and travel on the African continent. These national and international lecturers also conduct the annual Kemet Nu Know Thyself educational tours to Egypt and Ethiopia. Brother and Sister Kwesi link the historical with the present by means of visual documentation to bring our story to life. For lectures, videos, audio media, or Egypt and Ethiopia tour brochures, contact Ashra or Mary Rakwesi at Kemet Nu Productions, 214-371-0206. That's 214-371-0206. Or visit www.kemetnu.com. That's KEMETNU.com.